I don't think he's so tough.
No?
No.
How tough are you, babe?
That's a good.
Don't act like that.
Papa Nally.
Was he really that tough? That's the first question everyone asks about James Cagney.
Well, he didn't go around shooting cops and slugging women like he did here in the back lot of Warner Brothers. And this was a guy who'd cry if he had to spank his kids. People who knew him said he was quiet, introspective. Others said he was a fighter. He fought against big things. Poverty, injustice, this studio. One of his movies, he said, I don't take nothing from nobody. With Cagney, that wasn't just a line. That was a way of life. This is New York Street on the Warner Brothers back lot. A lot of James Cagney's movies were shot here. I've always been a big fan. In fact, a few years ago, when somebody asked me, how are you different from other actors your age? I said, they all want to be James Dean, I want to be James Cagney. Later, when I read it in print out of context, it seemed kind of flip, but anybody who knows something about James Cagney knows I wasn't being flip. I was being honest. In just about all of his 63 films, one thing was certain. It was Cagney who set things in motion. Whether he was a vicious gangster, a hard-nosed G-man, or Broadway star George M. Cohan, Jimmy never sat around waiting for things to happen. He made them happen. And it was the same in his life. Jimmy's story begins in turn-of-the-century New York. Back then, there was no tougher place than the tenements of the Lower East Side. This is where he was born on July 17th, 1899. And if he looked like this after that first slap, you gotta wonder what happened to that doctor. When Jimmy was two, his father, an Irish bartender, moved the family uptown to Yorkville, another rough neighborhood. In a rare audio tape interview, Jimmy said,
over there where we grew up, one had to be able to take care of oneself with the fists.
But redheaded Jimmy and his three brothers were no match for the neighborhood's toughest character, their mother.
Anytime that any of us got out of line, she didn't wait, she just belted us. And belted us good.
One of his fondest childhood memories was far from Yorkville. The occasion was a family trip to the country.
Jimmy was just astounded. He couldn't believe that there was such a place. And so as he grew up, he always remembered that, and that's where he always ran back to. You know, I had a farm in the East, and he loved that.
In high school, he applied to a New York agricultural college. But after a school rep visited the Cagneys in their neighborhood, they never heard from the school again. Show business wasn't even a second choice. That sort of happened by accident.
There was a fella who had some interest in show business, and he told me that if I could dance a little bit, that I could get a job with a vaudeville act that was up at the 81st Street Theater.
The act, Every Sailor, officially put him in show business. It also put him in a dress. James Cagney's first professional gig was in full drag. In 1920, he danced his way into the Broadway musical Pitter Patter. There he met a pretty chorus girl named Frances Willard Vernon, Billy to her friends. 2 years later, they were married. It would be the longest run of Jimmy's career, 64 years. The newlyweds took to the road, working in vaudeville, sometimes as a team, sometimes not. When Jimmy wasn't on stage, he was back in the wings, studying the headliners.
And I learned every act, routine, every song. Mostly it was the dancing that intrigued me, and I'd come away with the steps that the other fellas were doing.
On March 11th, 1930, he returned to Broadway, this time as a serious actor. Jimmy opened in the play Penny Arcade. He played opposite a pretty young actress named Joan Blondell.
Al Jolson saw the play, bought the play from the producers, then resold it to Warner Brothers. So he recommended that Blondell and I should be brought out to do our parts.
Just a few weeks after Penny Arcade opened, James Cagney was on a train for Hollywood. James Cagney arrived in Los Angeles on April 11th, 1930.
The initial impression was just what I would have had from any other town that I'd walked into on a tour. Vaudeville, it was another town, just another job to do.
When he got here, Warner's had him fill out this questionnaire. Under pet peeves, he wrote, aggressive dumbbells and silly questions. This one's even better. Reason for going into acting, needed a job. This was no starstruck kid.
Jimmy didn't seem to be anything special. At 5'6", he wasn't considered leading man material, I don't know why. The Warner Brothers signed him for only 3 weeks. To them, he was just another body to help fill the screen.
It was practically an assembly line in every studio. The studio owned the theaters. They had to supply the product for the theaters. Each studio made on the average of a picture a week, about 50 pictures a year. So it had to be an industry. It had to be an assembly line.
Penny Arcade was retitled Sinner's Holiday. After screening the early rushes, studio head Jack Warner saw that Jimmy was more than just another body.
Something's gonna happen to you.
No, Major, no.
Nobody's gonna peddle hoots around this park but me.
No, don't pull that rod, Major. I'm warning you. I got a gun, too.
Yeah, but you're dirty little yellow here. You don't get
no, please don't. I'm asking you. Please don't. I'm telling you. Please don't, Miss. Please don't. I'm telling you now. I'm asking you.
Jack Warner quickly ordered up a new contract. Jimmy was signed on for 5 years at $400 a week, and that was during the Depression. A couple of small parts followed. Then his first lead in the movie that would make him a star. The story was about Prohibition gangsters. The film was The Public Enemy.
Hey, Bjorn. Somebody's got to protect your customers.
But what am I going to do? I can't help it if I have to buy from Schemer Burns. They tell me the same thing that you do.
You're yellow.
Oh, please, you ain't going to slug me, are you?
Maybe not today. But I'm telling you this for the last time. When Dutch comes around, he's going to leave you some beer. And you're going to take it. And you're going to kick him with a dough. If you don't, somebody's going to drop by here and kick your teeth out one at a time. Get me?
The Public Enemy was the most vicious, violent gangster film audiences had ever seen. And some of the violence was real.
In the old days, they used real machine gun bullets in the scenes. The scene in Public Enemy when I ducked behind a stone wall, the machine gunner on a platform cut loose with the bullets and took the edge off the wall where I had been.
The movie's most powerful ammunition was fired by Jimmy himself.
I was in my dressing room preparing to take my makeup off when knock, 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 and it's Jimmy at the door. Yes, come in, Jim. Sat down, he said, my goodness, if we had just thought to do that little thing of pick up that grapefruit and smash it in your face at the end of the scene, what would that have done to the crew? He said, would you come back and do it one more time and do that?
Don't
now, this was not, to my understanding, to be used in the picture.
I didn't ask you for any lip. I asked you if you had a drink.
I know, Tom, but, I wish that...
There you go, that wishing stuff again. I wish you was a wishing well. Could I like a tie a bucket to you and sink you?
Maybe you found someone you like better.
Oh. 60 years I've been answering this question. How did it feel to have that grapefruit pushed in your face by James Cagney? I said, wet.
Cagney was the toughest character anyone had ever seen in the movies. To him, the law was for suckers. He just took what he wanted. And Depression audiences, tired of being pushed around by big business and government, ate it up. Warner Brothers immediately rushed Jimmy through two more films, then allowed him some time off. He and Billy returned to New York for an unpaid vacation. In Times Square, he saw crowds lined up around the block for The Public Enemy. Everywhere he went, people stopped him for his autograph. $400 a week no longer seemed like a fair slice of the pie. But Warner Brothers held him to his contract.
They had a couple of people on the lot who were stars, and they were getting $125,000 a picture. And here I was up above the title just as they were, and I was getting $400 a week. That didn't last long. I walked out.
2 days later, the studio suspended his contract. Almost as soon as it began, James Cagney's movie career seemed to be over. When Warner Brothers said no to a raise, Jimmy turned his back on Hollywood. Meanwhile, Smart Money and Blonde Crazy, the two films he did before walking out, were released. Both were hits. Jack Warner wasn't about to let pride interfere with profits, so he gave Jimmy a new contract.
Well, they buried a hatchet, have they? I'd like to bury the hatchet. Right in their thick skulls.
Jimmy's salary jumped from $400 to $1,400 a week. He went to work on one of his best early films, Taxi. And with co-star Loretta Young, he was as good with the sweet stuff as he was with the rough stuff.
I see him getting plenty of ice.
What'd you expect, the brass band?
I suppose I am a sucker for coming back for more punishment.
That door works both ways.
Oh, come on, don't be that way. Nobody'll like you.
You, for instance?
Mm-hmm, for instance.
Of all the conceited guys I've ever met in my life, you take first prize. What makes you think you're so good? You're not so hot.
Well, I thought you meant it. Stay that way.
In Taxi, Cagney played a hot-headed cabbie and union organizer.
We're living in the United States. We're free and equal, or so they tell us. And we got a right to a living if we want to go out and get it. Now we got to show those dirty finks that they can't take the bread and butter out of our mouths.
In real life, Jimmy's politics leaned the same way in the 1930s.
Come on, you poor workers.
He gave money to aid striking field workers in the San Joaquin Valley, striking miners in Harlan County, Kentucky. Soon he was protesting the working conditions in Hollywood.
They were squeezing as much out of us as they could. The 10-hour day, the 12-hour day. Sometimes we would work from 8 o'clock in the morning on Saturday right through to sunup, pushing us to a point where we were so damned exhausted we couldn't see.
Jimmy wasn't the only one complaining. He and other gutsy stars formed the Screen Actors Guild in October 1933. Jimmy became their first vice president. Within 6 weeks, the new union had 4,000 members, and working conditions began to improve for all actors. Back on the screen, art imitated life. Jimmy remained cocky, defiant, forever standing his ground.
That's a big difficulty. You see, when you play a great many of those parts, you become fixed in the public mind as that kind of character. But the plans are in the future that I play an entirely different variety of roles.
Warner's plans for Cagney didn't include much variety. But even when he didn't like the role, the Cagney charm never let up, especially with Mae Clark.
What is it?
Yeah, you're the doll.
You dropped this in the lobby of the Randolph Hotel. I tried to catch it, but you're too fast for me.
Oh, thank you. I didn't miss it until I got home. I wondered where I lost it. Won't you come in a minute?
Who could say no?
Lady Killer had him pulling me by the hair of the head across the length of two floors. Pulled my hair, only it didn't pull my hair. He got a hold of my hair, but I got a hold of his wrist. And when he just walked away, I went with it. Now, I wouldn't have known that, but he did. He was a dancer, essentially. Everything that James Cagney did was choreographed.
Choreography also played a big part in Jimmy's fight scenes, and he made all the right moves.
All right, let's take it.
Early on, we discovered that any time I hit anybody my own size, it looked as though I was taking advantage of them. So I always insisted upon having a man bigger than myself.
In 1933, he finally got the chance to do something he'd been pushing for, a big-budget Busby Berkeley musical, Footlight Parade. With Ruby Keeler, movie audiences finally saw Jimmy as he saw himself, a song and dance man. The movie was a big hit. Fans even sent in a petition for Jimmy to do more dancing. But there were no plans to put Cagney in another musical.
He wasn't actually a Gene Kelly type. I mean, he was short, pugnacious. You never thought of him as a dancer. Somehow, he got into that gangster mold and it just seemed to fit him. And they would never change that.
Instead, Jimmy was teamed up with an old friend from his Broadway days, Pat O'Brien. Their first film together was Here Comes the Navy.
Get a load of $3 a day anvil, bring in a new flock of suckers.
Oh, now don't start anything.
All right, sailors, come on. Hustle along, get going. Hey, that's a mug that put on a show for those dames this morning. Watch this. Oh!
All right, what wise guy yell that?
I did. What are you gonna do about it?
Oh, so it's you again, Redhead, huh? Well, nothing's gonna happen now, but plenty when I get back from this detail. Stick around and see what's gonna pop.
Go on, Boy Scout, get going before somebody takes your toy sailors away from you.
Over there, hard! Hard, hard! All right, wise guy, but we'll meet again.
Jimmy and Pat became lifelong pals. They did 8 pictures together. Jimmy was the wild one and Pat the straight arrow, at least in the movies.
Dad was a total extrovert because Dad loved people and he loved to entertain and he loved to talk to people on the street.
And Dad was just the opposite. He went to bed early, was up at the crack of dawn, preferred reading, and didn't do socializing.
Jimmy did have a regular boys' night out. He'd go out with Pat and pals like Spencer Tracy, Ralph Bellamy, Frank McHugh, Alan Jenkins. The press called them the Irish Mafia. Mostly they drank and laughed about everything from studio politics to bad scripts. Of course, even James Cagney showed respect for this writer.
Let me play the lion, too. I will roar you that I will do any man's heart good to hear me.
My mother one day said, let's go see your dad in the movie, because we've never seen one. It was Midsummer's Night's Dream at a theater in Beverly Hills, and I think I was 5 or 6, something like that. And they come to the scene where Mickey Rooney is playing Puck, and where he sprinkles the stardust on Dad's head, and he suddenly has the head of a donkey. And I freaked out. And I started screaming as loud as I could. I don't want a donkey for a father. What is, you know? Took off out of my seat, ran up to the screen, and I'm pounding on it. I don't want a donkey for a father. I don't want a donkey for a father. Then they had to find my father and make me realize that he was not a donkey.
This was the only time Jimmy ever let the studio make an ass out of him. That same year, when Jack Warner put him in more pictures than their agreement called for, not only did Jimmy walk out, he sued Warner's for breach of contract. He and his wife, Billy, left town, leaving the whole matter in the hands of a new manager, his brother, Bill. Then Jimmy did something that was really important to him. 3,000 miles from Hollywood, he bought a 100-acre farm on Martha's Vineyard.
It was just an old, old house, 1728 with the date of the deed, and everything about it charmed me just out of my shoes.
Jimmy went to work rejuvenating the soil, breeding horses, raising cattle. 20 years after his rejection from agricultural college, Jimmy was finally a farmer.
He was a farmer at heart, yeah. Pat O'Brien called him the faraway fella because he was a kind of a dreamer, you know. He loved sitting and watching it rain, you know.
Back here in California, Cagney's breach of contract suit against Warner's was heating up. On March 18, 1936, in the California Superior Court, Jimmy won his suit, and Warner Brothers lost one of its biggest stars.
Well, on Christmas, Jimmy said he got a clock from Jack Warner as a present, and he opened it up, and it had a note. Warner had a note in it that says, "This clock won't work either."
Didn't take Jimmy long to get back on the screen. A new company, Grand National Film, signed him up at $100,000 a picture. Jimmy was happy to be doing another musical, but the small company couldn't really compete with the major studios. After two films, Bill Cagney was back negotiating with Jack Warner. Bill closed a $150,000 a picture deal with the studio that included story approval. Cagney was back at Warner's, and some of his best work was ahead of him. As gangster Rocky Sullivan in Angels with Dirty Faces, Jimmy locked horns with the Dead End Kids.
Who's the leader?
I am.
Come here. Collect that dough, and fast.
Come on, hand it over. Me too, come on.
Yeah. Now get him up and turn around.
What? Hey, what?
After this scene, the kids idolized Rocky, even when he was sentenced to the electric chair.
You'll never make him crack.
Nothing yell about Rocky.
You bet.
Remember what he said at the trial? He said he'd spit in their eye. He'll do it, too. He'll laugh at him.
It was up to Pat O'Brien to see that good triumphed over evil.
They've got to despise your memory. Got to be ashamed of you.
You asked me to pull an act, join Yella, so those kids will think I'm no good. You asked me to throw away the only thing I got left, the only thing I've been able to take away from me. You want me to give those newspaper synopsis a chance to say another act, join Yella.
But Rocky, you and I all know that you're not.
You're asking a nice little favor, Jerry. Ask me to crawl on my belly, last thing I do in life.
I know what I'm asking.
Jimmy's final scene made movie history. Was he yellow, or was he trying to do the right thing? As Jimmy later admitted, you have to decide.
I don't want to stay in your yard.
Next, Jimmy gave the Wild West a touch of the East Side in The Oklahoma Kid.
You'll be sorry when you see me sliding down our cellar door.
Kid, I want to talk to you.
Keep on playing.
I said I want to talk to you.
Well, go ahead and talk.
My name's Whit McCord. That mean anything to you?
How does it?
McCord.
McCord, McCord, McCord. I don't like it, do you?
I want that Indian money.
Well, go and get it from the Indians.
Kid, I'm giving you a break because I'm pressed for time.
Don't you raise that bottle of me, Bert Soupin.
Give me that bottle.
Get over there.
Get over.
Play, Professor.
Bogey later gets even with Cagney, but not in the movie. He told the press, in that 10-gallon hat, he looks like a mushroom.
Cagney had the last word, though.
Driving home from the studio, he saw Bogart in the car beside him, and Bogey was preoccupied. That night, Jimmy sent him this poem.
In this silly town of ours, one sees odd primps and poses, but movie stars and fancy cars shouldn't pick their famous noses. I never got an answer.
By now, Jimmy was one of the top 10 wage earners in the country. He and Billy adopted a son and daughter, James Jr. and Casey.
And I remember it, wonderful, wonderful feeling, of having both of them sit on my lap, and I would tell them stories.
Another kind of story broke in the summer of 1940. Several movie stars were accused of being members of the Communist Party. Former communist John R. Leach was naming names, and one of them was Jimmy's. Harry Warner immediately contacted Bill Cagney and threatened to ruin Jimmy. While Jimmy vacationed on the vineyard, Bill went to work setting up the most important appearance of his brother's career. The charge that James Cagney was a communist was front page news across the country. Jimmy was on vacation, but this kind of thing ended careers back then. In spite of a fear of flying, he got on a plane for the first time in his life. In California, Bill Cagney arranged a meeting between his brother and the chairman of the Committee on Un-American Activities, Congressman Martin Dies. Jimmy had given money to the defense fund for the Scottsboro Boys, 9 teenagers from Alabama wrongly accused of rape. His check wound up hanging in the Communist Party office in San Francisco. Jimmy met with Martin Dies, and he must have been convincing. After 15 minutes, Dies cleared Jimmy of all charges.
He went in to interview Cagney, and he came out with Cagney's autographed picture. That was the big laugh around the studio.
But to Bill Cagney, clearing Jimmy in people's minds was no laughing matter. He told his brother, "We have to make the damnedest patriotic picture ever." Work soon began on the script for Yankee Doodle Dandy. Jimmy went all out getting ready for the role of legendary song and dance man George M. Cohan. With Michael Curtiz directing, brother Bill producing, and his sister Jean in the cast, Jimmy began shooting Yankee Doodle Dandy on December 8, 1941.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941.
It was the day after Pearl Harbor, and President Roosevelt came on the radio, and we tuned it on the set and listened to him declare war. I remember we all stood around dead still, a lot of extras on the set, you know, and we all became rather quiet, and Jimmy said, I think this is a good place for a little prayer. It was a good time to turn out a picture like that. There was a scene that he did that was so remarkable. Everyone on the lot, I think, was affected by it. It was when he said goodbye, as it were, to his dying father.
How many curtain calls it takes you, Max?
Six. Six curtains.
That's pretty good for a drama.
Yeah.
To make his peace?
Mm-hmm. I thank them for us. I said my mother thanks you. My father thanks you. My sister thanks you. I thank you.
Mike Curtiz spoiled a take because of crying so loud he couldn't control it. The script girl cried so much that she blurred the ink on the notes on her script. It was quite a moment.
But the moments that Jimmy liked best were the ones when he was dancing.
I'm a Yankee Doodle Dandy. Yankee Doodle do or die. A real live nephew of my Uncle Sam, born on the 4th of July. I've got a Yankee Doodle sweetheart. She's my Yankee Doodle joy. Yankee Doodle came to London just to ride the ponies. I am and that Yankee Doodle boy.
He's a Yankee Doodle dandy, a Yankee Doodle do or die. A real life, everyone is Uncle Sam, born on the 4th of July. He's got a Yankee Doodle sweetheart, she's his Yankee Doodle joy. Yankee Doodle came to London just to ride a pony.
Yankee Doodle Dandy was Jimmy's biggest hit.
James Cagney and Yankee Doodle Dandy.
And it won him his only Academy Award.
Ladies and gentlemen, you can only be as good as the other fellow thinks you are. Or, I might add, as bad. And it seems that quite a number of people have thought a good job has been done. And that makes me very happy. And just one added thought, I might say, it was a pretty good part. Thank you.
After Jimmy danced down those White House stairs, his politics were never questioned again. On the strength of Yankee Doodle, the Cagneys left Warner's to make their own movies. Movies with a variety of roles for Jimmy. Jack Warner said, "He'll find out. He needs me as much as I need him." While setting up Cagney Productions, Jimmy became chairman of the Hollywood Victory Committee during the war.
The first of the Jeeps, Jimmy Cagney.
On behalf of the motion picture industry, I want to say that we're going to continue to sell shares in the USA. Now, you can buy some of those shares by buying a bond at the box office. You hear? Thanks very much.
Jimmy also toured overseas military bases and hospitals, bringing encouragement and entertainment to the troops. Over the next 5 years, Cagney Productions made several films. Their third was William Saroyan's philosophical play, The Time of Your Life. It was also their last.
I've been trying for 3 years to find out if it's possible to live what I think is a civilized life, a life that can't hurt any other life.
You're famous?
Very. Utterly unknown, but very famous.
We lost $500,000 on that Time of Your Life. It was a very unhappy situation.
Jimmy was a good businessman, though. And if he had a failure, he'd look it straight in the eye and say, well, I better go back to what I was doing to make some more money.
Warner Brothers had a script that they wanted me to do. So my brother Bill said to them, all right, Jim will do it if you give the first $500,000 to the banks.
Jimmy proved well worth it. His first film back at Warner's was one of his best, White Heat.
You won't get away with it, Cody.
Cody, huh? Go get the car started. You've got a good memory for names. Too good.
I remember the first day on the set. He didn't seem too anxious. I don't think he cared about doing another gangster film, which this was, White Heat.
Cagney played vicious killer Cody Jarrett.
How you doing, Parker?
Stuffy in here. I need some air.
Oh, stuffy, huh? I'll give it a layer.
It was Cagney at his most psychotic, a gun-crazy mama's boy.
Don't let them see you like that. Might give some of them ideas.
Always thinking about your Cody, aren't you?
That's right.
One scene, Jimmy said, if I kick the chair out from under you, will you be all right? Will you fall back on the bed and not hurt yourself? I said, yes, I can do it. It's easy. So we did it. We did it in one take.
We had enough food in the house for a week. What you had to go out for?
You like strawberries, don't you? Well, she just had to get some for her boy.
No, it wasn't in the script. It was just these little additions that Jimmy would make to every scene.
Ask him how my mother is.
For the famous prison mess hall scene, Jimmy recalled a disturbing memory from his childhood. visiting the uncle of a friend at an insane asylum. White Heat was classic Cagney. Jimmy called it just another cheap jack job, but that's understandable. For almost 20 years, he'd been trying to get away from the tough guy image formed here at Warner Brothers. Now, with this one film, that image was fixed in the minds of a whole new generation of moviegoers. After White Heat, Cagney did a few more pictures in the early 50s. By then, he was working as a free agent for all the studios, like actors today. 1955 was a particularly good year. In Mr. Roberts, he worked with a young actor he'd seen on television, but who was still fairly new to the movies.
We talked about everything under the sun. One of the crew members was asking him about acting, and Jimmy said, "You get it? You make it so complicated." He said, "Look, learn your lines. Plant your feet, look the other actor in the eye, and say the words, but mean them."
Pulva! How is it I don't see you around much, Pulva?
Often wondered the same thing myself, sir.
What's your job, Pulva?
Officer in charge of laundry and morale, sir.
How long have you been aboard, Pulva?
"14 months, sir."
That same year, Jimmy danced with Bob Hope in The Seven Little Foys, doing steps he hadn't done in years. As soon as they started, screaming pain shot down both Jimmy's legs. He was in agony, but he pushed through the entire number. You'd never know it from this scene, but age was catching up with Jimmy Cagney. In 1961, Jimmy did Billy Wilder's rapid-fire comedy, 1, 2, 3.
Sitzen machen.
Billy wanted to shoot a certain scene where it was rat-a-tat-tat-tat-tat-tat-tat. And he had about 2 pages solid or more of dialogue. Well, Jimmy began to have trouble. At some point after hours of it, Jimmy said, "We took a 5, and I leaned back against the wall of that stage, and I looked up. And I said, Cagney, it's over. If you can't do this in 1, get out."
"Yes, Mr. McNamara."
"Ready?"
"Always ready."
"First, call Reinhardt and Reinhardt Custom Tailors and have them send up everything they've got in their shop. Single breast, a 3-button, narrow lapels, medium grade, a dark blue, size 39 regular. Next, call Plesky the Haberdasher. I want to see some shirts. Broadcloth, plain or tab collar, size 15 1/2, 34. Shorts, nylon or cotton, size 32. Socks, French lisle, dark tone, size 11 1/2. Ties, not too wide, not too narrow, not too fancy. Also pajamas, handkerchiefs, cufflinks, suspenders, etc., etc. Next, call Hochstetter's. Have them deliver some shoes, British or Italian models, brown and black, size 9B. Yes, Fritz. No, Fritz, I need you. Sleepy or not sleepy, everybody works today.
They finally got it. But Jimmy had made his mind up.
31 years after it began, James Cagney's movie career was over. No fuss, No fear. He just called it a day and went home.
I love acting. That was not true of Jimmy. Acting was a blessing to Jimmy because it gave him the income and the ability to pursue other interests. He loved to write, he loved to paint, he was nuts about horses, as we know, and he could live the life that he wanted to with other interests because of the acting.
By the early 70s, Jimmy had been out of the limelight for over a decade. Then, in 1974, he was pulled back into it for the American Film Institute's Life Achievement Award. All of Hollywood came out for the event.
He went out and the house just went wild. He looked so good in his tuxedo he had done, and he was all trimmed down. It was just perfect, perfect night from the beginning to the end.
I'm a wreck. You know, when my friend A.C. Lyles told me of the plans that the AFI had for this evening, it gave me pause. And I said to him, you know, this is not the kind of thing I do every day. What will they expect of me? And he said, oh, well, all you have to do is, And I said, what's that? He said, all you have to do is, So I'm saying to all of you right now, with a little bit of necessary emphasis,
Jimmy thanked a lot of people that night, even his old boss.
J.L., Jack Warner, who gave me a name I shall always cherish, affectionately, mind you, the professional against her. But we're old now and full of understanding, and that's all water over the dam.
He also set the record straight.
Just in passing, I never said, you dirty rat. What I actually did say was, Judy, Judy, Judy.
13 years away from the camera, and he still had it. Jimmy's life for a film, the movie would have ended with the AFI Award. The years that followed brought illness and decline. Jimmy came back for two more films, including a small part in Ragtime. But the Cagney energy just wasn't there.
I was back at the farm, and I did something I'd been doing for years. I hugged him, and he hugged me. I got to the door, and something told me it was the last time I was going to see Jim alive. And I turned and went back to the bed and hugged him again. As I stood up, he said, I know why you did that.
On Easter Sunday, 1986, James Cagney died. Movie audiences always loved James Cagney. He was a movie star the city could call its own. A street kid who made good with his fists and his charm. For those who'd never been to New York or Chicago, James Cagney was the big city. Dangerous, unpredictable. Exciting. In 1985, I was lucky enough to meet James Cagney. He was 86, but when we shook hands, his grip was so strong, it was like he was saying, kid, I could still knock you on your ass. Like Jimmy, we'd all like to say, I don't take nothing from nobody. Maybe that's why we like Cagney best as a tough guy. Jimmy knew he was a lot more than that, but he learned early on he'd have to tough it out to get the chance to prove it. And if he hadn't, just think what we might have missed.
Thank you. give my regards to Broadway. Remember me to Herald Square. Tell all the gang at 42nd Street that I will soon be there. Whisper of how I'm yearning to mingle with that old-time throng. Give my regards to old Broadway and say that I'll be there ere long.
We'll give your regards.